Hey, Dr. Vinay Prasad here from the University of California, San Francisco, and I'm back with a new video, by request, called How to Publish a Research Paper, a Guide for Clinicians. Before I get into how to think about publishing a research paper, I want to outline some of my guiding principles. Now, I think one of the mistakes here is to think that a research paper solely serves your professional interests or professional benefit. And I think that's true. Research papers do help you in your career. But we can't forget that the other purpose of a research paper is a societal benefit. The knowledge should be contributing to scientific understanding of an issue. Good science has a societal positive benefit. Bad science is deeply harmful and problematic for science. But the problem is, good science and bad science may both be in your personal professional interest. And that is a tension. So when it comes to your professional interest versus society's interest, I have a clear winner. Society wins. So if it's between you publishing one additional paper and publishing something that's accurate and meaningful and that'll advance the field, I think you always have to err on the side of the second concept, doing accurate work, even if that means burying some papers because they are flawed and simply don't contribute to scientific understanding. So this video's got two parts. There are two types of people out there. Are you an independent or nearing the end of your training researcher, sort of launching your career? Or are you a pre-medical or early career researcher? And I'm going to talk about both in turn. So first, independent or fellow researchers. Now, let's say you're a fellow, you're an independent researcher, and you want to publish a research paper. You're in this moment in time. Well, I have to submit that you're pretty far along the process already, and we got to back up a little bit. 6 months ago, you probably should have been reading many, many papers in that topic or field that you wish to contribute to. I would say at least 20 papers in that field. You need to get a sense of what was the lay of the land. What does that field look like? And it's actually a little bit more complicated than that, because 6 months ago, you need to be reading lots of papers in lots of different fields because you do not yet know the field that you want to contribute a research publication in. Now, this could be a narrow domain. For instance, it could be GI oncology or melanoma, but you still need to be reading about different concepts, different ideas in that field, thinking broadly about it. And then, only then, after a period of time, of discussion, do you get to the point where you want to publish a research paper. So what is your idea? I think it's very important that when you set out to publish a research paper, you clearly articulate, I want to test whatever it is. I want to examine whatever it is. I want to study this topic. And ask yourself, what do you seek to find? Or what do you hope to prove? What do you wish you might see? And then, before you even start, do a Google Scholar search to see if that question has already been answered. And you might be surprised. The things that you think are very clever have already been answered many, many times over. So let's say it hasn't been done. You've clearly articulated what it is you want to do, why you think it's important, it hasn't been done. Then I think the next question in your mind is to ask yourself, how might you study it? What is the ideal way this question could be studied? What is the absolute best way somebody might examine this question? Think about that ideal way, and then set it aside for a second and think about what's the best way you can address that question with the tools at your disposal. And I think those are going to be different things in all but the rarest cases. And then the key question is the best way you can address something with your tools still close enough to the concept? Does it still get at the thing sufficiently that it is worth doing? Or is it still so distant that it's best you give up, abort the project from the outset? And I think that's a really deep question, and good researchers have the courage to admit, I cannot answer the question I want. I cannot even get close enough that's meaningful, so I will give up on it. So before you start, is the question important? Is it useful? Is it interesting? That's a key facts that have to go into your sort of thinking about the question. The next question I like to ask, what's the best place that I could publish this article? Let's say I find, you know, the hypothesis is true. Let me say I find the hypothesis is false. What's the best place I could publish this article, irrespective of what I find? And then I ask, is that a venue that is actually read or interests others or contributes to the discussion in that way? Now, I want to be very careful. I'm not advising you to chase impact factor. But at the same time, I do believe you should aspire to write articles that people will read. And there are a number of journals that people will not read. They don't read. You don't read them, and no one else reads them. They are simply adding to scientific noise, but don't really contribute to scientific signal. So you want to have a project that you think, at least you believe, if it goes well, could have an impact on your field, whatever, however big or small you see that as. Then I think to myself, how much effort will this take? Do I have the bandwidth to take it on? And here's a key question. Why you? Why you? What do you bring to the table that other people don't bring? Why are you uniquely suited to take this question on? And related to that, will I be scooped? So there are a lot of people out there who have tremendous investment and energy and have built strong research enterprises. And for certain types of questions, particularly obvious questions or forced move questions, they are actively pursuing them and they are highly likely to scoop you. So you really want a question that's unique, that you're unlikely to be scooped, that you're the best person suited to ask it and answer it, that really is a meaningful question. It does matter. It hasn't been asked before, and it could publish well. That's the kind of question you really want to take on. So I show this diagram again. Over on the left is many, many, many things that are going on. You reading broadly, thinking about topics or ideas. You want to publish a research paper. That's this moment in time. And here, covered by my face, is you are actually going to do it. The number of ideas you need to have that you're thinking about, the number of ideas that you start to screen to perform a research study, and the idea you actually take forward, this should be much broader than what you actually take forward. You should be thinking about 100 ideas for every one idea you set out to do. And I think this is the part about research that people don't really get, is that this work on the back end is not rewarded, it's not compensated for, but it's key if you really want to do impactful, meaningful science. So now let's say you get to the point where you actually have a clear project that no one else has answered, you're uniquely suited to take on, and it has potential to be influential. Who are you going to partner with? Who do you want on your team? Don't forget statisticians. They're going to be very grateful you brought them aboard, and please allocate some funds for them. But who else do you want on the team? Do you want a trainee on the team? Do you want a more senior colleague? Who will make the team strong? Whose input do you need? And then I think you're still not ready to start. Bounce the idea off a friend or two or three. What holes do they see? What are the limitations they envision? What are the problems? Often at this stage, talking to somebody about the idea, the concept, can save you a world of time. And then I think it's key, once you assemble your team or whoever you're working on this with, draft a protocol, draft some methods. I put a question mark next to registering that. For certain types of questions, you really ought to register it. IRB approval. I'll leave that to the particular situation you're in. But I think it's important that you at least get down on paper what it is you want to do and how you're going to do it. And then even before you go forward, sleep on it one last time. And then you've decided, you've committed, this is worth doing, you've got the team, you've thought about many things, you've whittled it down to one key idea, do it. And now, don't procrastinate. Just get it done. It's important to do it while you have the energy and the enthusiasm and while people are really keen on seeing the results. And then see what you get. Generate tables and figures, summarize central results, describe the data before you start to analyze the data. Look at the data, think about the data, reflect on the data before you analyze the data. And then when you're set on how you want to present your data, write it up to mirror the best articles you read. Look for some examples. Be an active reader and draw upon those examples in how you write up your paper. There's an old quote by Hemingway. It says, "Long periods of thinking, short periods of writing." That was the key to his success. Now I wish to make a corollary for research science, which is long periods of thinking, short periods of research. Good research scientists spend an order of magnitude more time thinking about the field, learning about the field, asking questions in their mind about the field, trying to answer those in the literature, and shorter periods of time actually doing the research. This is the key to doing good science. There's a great quote by Tversky, "You waste years by not being able to waste hours." And I think what he's getting at is this idea that often it is taking it slow, thinking about it, being very deliberate about sizing up the importance of what you're studying, that helps you do good science. And if you don't have the time to do that, you might waste years of your life on research projects that are empty and meaningless. Now let me shift gears to pre-medical and early career researchers. Now I want to come back to my guiding principles. I have not forgotten about these, even for pre-medical scientists and early career researchers. Professional benefit, societal benefit. Society only benefits from good science, not bad science, but both benefit you. And if ever there is a tension between those two things, you need to abort your project. Society always wins. It's not about you. It's about doing science that advances the field. And this is true even in the pre-medical space. I think the goal of pre-med research is different. It shouldn't be thought of as getting an output, a publication or a poster. It's really to see if this is right for you, if this type of work, this type of thinking is what you want to do with your life. I think you have to get over the fact really quickly of thinking of researchers as living somehow some glamorous life or being very successful, or that they're doing something that's better than just seeing patients. Remember, this is a lecture for clinical researchers. Seeing patients is an indisputable good. You're doing a great service. For you to embark on research, you have to know it's right for you in a way that is true to who you are. You shouldn't just do it for the sake of doing it. And that's really the purpose of doing research at this stage, is to see, is this right for you? Is this something you want to do? So how do you go about it? Don't pick a project based on the discipline you want to go into. Yawn. That's boring. Each year, there are hundreds, perhaps thousands, of absolute rubbish orthopedic, neurosurgical, or dermatologic projects, because those are the fields in which there's often a lot of demand from the side of students. You don't want to do that. Don't just do a publication because you want to go into a field. That's a grave mistake. Here's how you should go about it. Pick folks who you want to learn from. Who are people that you've encountered in your clinical training who are also researchers who have these characteristics? Are they friendly? Are they accessible? Can you actually reach them and talk to them? Or are they so world famous that they barely are present at your university, live in an airplane? Are they anti-hierarchical? This is a key thing. There are some people who still like the rigid hierarchies of the past, and they don't allow you as a junior person to really say what you think or what you feel. And there are other people who just invite that, and you can just feel comfortable with them, and you say what you want to say. And those are the people you want to gravitate to, because you'll be more comfortable to speak your own mind and to ask the questions that you want answered. Is it a relaxed environment? Are you comfortable talking to this person? And is this person open to letting you explore things and ideas, or are they really endpoint focused? So you want all these traits. And look at this list. I don't have highly productive researcher on this list. It's the human traits that are really more important here. Though I do believe that they should know how to do research. That's a key prerequisite. So do you work with somebody or do you work by yourself? This is a question people often ask me. And I guess I want to say that if you're so advanced that you want to work by yourself, you really should go to the first part of this talk. That's the state that you're in right now. But if you are a trainee who's not that advanced, you might not have a good sense of the field or what great questions are, and you really do want to work with somebody. So for regular folks, for regular trainees, when you find that person you want to pair with, try to see if they have a representative project or work that sort of captures what it is they do and the type of work they do. And I think it's key. You don't want to commit right off the bat. You want to try to wait to commit till you know you are interested and you have the bandwidth to do it. And what that means is that after you talk to somebody, you take a few weeks and you read about the topic. You read a bunch of articles in that space. You read some of their articles and you see, is this person doing stuff that I might find interesting? When you go back to meet with that person, I don't want to use the word mentor, but that's who I'm talking about. Discuss the timeline. When do they expect this project to culminate over? How long do you think it's going to take? I put a question mark next to discussing authorship because I know people get burned, and for that reason, you might have to discuss it because there are people out there who will burn you, and that's, I believe, wrong. On the other hand, I think you should go into this with a different set of expectations. You really shouldn't want the authorship more than you want the experience and to know if this is sort of right for you or not. That's worth more than a paper. I'd say double check your enthusiasm level. You don't want to do something if you really don't have your heart in it. Think twice before taking it on. And if you do decide to take it on, when you do, give it your best. You know, don't do this. Don't put it off. Don't procrastinate. If you take it on, do it right away and enjoy doing it. You know, it should be that sort of project. I also think it's okay to give up. You know, some people say don't give up, just make sure you get it done. I don't think that's the case. If you really find things change and you have to give up, set up an in-person meeting and go in there and throw in the towel. And I think this is important, and it's fair to say that, you know, I didn't have the bandwidth or this project didn't speak to me. I'm happy to turn over whatever I've done to another researcher. You got to be really honest when you do work like this. You got to be really diligent and do the best science you can. And the goal, of course, is to see if you like it, if this is the sort of career path you want to be on. And it's okay not to like it. And there's nothing, I think, glamorous about this path. So this talk is a bit deceptive. It's entitled, How to Publish a Research Paper, A Guide for Clinicians. That part was true. But it's really something more. It's about whether, when, and how to approach taking on a research project in the first place. Once you take it on, once you commit to a research project, particularly as a senior or leading academic or investigator, you got to commit to seeing it through and publishing it irrespective of the results. Don't get me wrong. But you should be very careful about what you select to do, and you should never do something just to do something. This isn't about buffing your CV. Every paper you put out should contribute to some sort of broader discussion or broader piece of scholarship. You know, I'm reminded of something the writer Jeffrey Eugenides said. He said that if he published everything he'd ever written, he'd have written a lot more books. But his reputation as a writer will be diminished. I think that's true in science too. It isn't necessarily the sheer number of papers that you've published, although some people foolishly and incorrectly use that as a metric. Your reputation as a scientist is in part based on the quality and the caliber and the importance of what you publish on, and you do want to be selective and not waste your time on projects that are unlikely to amount to a hill of beans. So, if you like this video, like, subscribe, leave a comment, and check out the podcast plenary session where I go into a deep dive on many topics.